of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount, I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise mine Ebenezer, hither by thy help I'm come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Sing of my Redeemer and his wondrous love to me. On the cruel cross he suffered from the curse to set me free. Sing, oh, sing of my Redeemer.
Every year on Thanksgiving, we're reminded that gratitude is a decision that we get to make. There are many things that are out of our control. The children won't stop getting older. The headlines keep getting crazier. The Christmas advertisements keep starting earlier and earlier every single year. The world around us is always changing, and there's a lot that we don't get to decide. But gratitude is a decision that we get to make. So let's decide to keep opening our doors. Let's decide to set the table and join hands. Let's decide that no matter what may come, our words to Jesus will always be, "Thank you."
Good morning. I want to welcome all of you who we are seeing face to face, and as well as those that may be joining us online. It's my privilege. I'm John.
And I'm Patty.
And we are together up here to welcome you this morning, and thank you for coming out, as well as those online again. Thank you for joining us. So let's, before we go any further, let's have prayer. Father in heaven, thank you for the privilege to acknowledge you. And please, may Holy Spirit find this place in each heart. And Jesus, you as well. We want to honor you and help us to do this. We cannot do it alone. We come to you as we are. We're dishonorable in heart. We're broken, damaged because of sin. But praise God, we have a Savior, Jesus Christ. And today, we take hold of you, Jesus. And we want to know that you take hold of us. So may you please affirm your love, your acceptance to each one, and keep us close to your heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I have just a couple announcements. This coming Wednesday, the Redeemer Church has invited us to join them for fellowship and fun. We're going to meet here in the church for a little worship at 7 p.m. on what day? Wednesday, this coming Wednesday. And then go ice skating at 8:30. So call the church office or click the link in the church email if you would like to join in the ice skating fun. Next Friday, which is the day after Thanksgiving, you guys are on it. We will be decorating the church for Christmas at 10 a.m. When?
10 a.m.
On what day?
Friday.
Day after? Oh, you, all right. So please spare your time and come on down the day after Thanksgiving at 10 a.m. to decorate for Christmas. December 1st, Heather is holding LaDonna Chaffin's 90th birthday party. It's going to be an open house from 1 to 4. So please RSVP by Wednesday, okay, if you're going to plan on going to the open house. And just cards only, no gifts, and just light refreshments. December 7th, there's an all-church potluck at Vicki Fuller's. On what day? Oh, you guys are really great. Okay, and just wanted to let you know that there's not going to be a children's story during church today, but right, I know, I'm sorry. I'm going to have to break out the crackers then during church so that he can keep him quiet, yeah. Anyway, there's no children's story today, but there is a kids during church. So right after the new members and their families are introduced, the kids can go back and join the kids during church, okay? Thank you.
LaDonna's thing.
December 1. At Heather's.
From 1 to 4.
From 1 to 4. December 1, 1 to 4. Are you testing me? Okay. Okay. Oh.
On that ice skating thing as well, you don't have to be ice skating. I think you can just go And if you want to be there with downtown where the tent is and just fellowship, you can do that. It's not that you have to go ice skating. So let's clarify that.
Good deal, because I can't.
All right. We're jumping right into it today. I know normally we have our meet and greet, we have children's story. Well, for one thing, Uncle Doug was supposed to do children's story, and Uncle Doug is in Hawaii right now. So he's not here to do children's story. But since it's a special Sabbath and we start a little bit late, we decided to streamline things a little bit. So if you're wondering why you're not meeting and greeting this morning, that's why. But we have some special things going on in the service today. We are welcoming some new people into our church, and I'd like to invite them up. There is two people that are getting baptized, Catherine and Jamie. I'd like to invite you guys to come up. They're going to get baptized today. Woo-woo, so excited. Very excited. Yeah, give them a hand. And I'd also like to invite up Norton and Linnea and Anna Laurel and Jacob. And you know, you guys have probably seen all these guys floating around here for a while, right? But they're formally joining the church by baptism and by profession of faith. Amen. Yes. So we're super excited. Come on, scoot on down. I'm going to stand behind you. I want to pray a blessing over all of you guys. We want to see your faces up here so that you guys can welcome them officially, so you know what they all look like and give them your love. And we're just going to pray a blessing over all of them right now. If you just bow your head with me. Dear Father in heaven, we are so thankful that you are growing our family, that we can welcome these wonderful people in officially. We are so happy to put our arms around them and share your love with them. And we know, Lord, that you are happy to have them joining this church community, committing their lives to you. And Lord, we know that all heaven is present with us and rejoicing as we celebrate this day. Lord, we want to pray your anointing on all of them, that your spirit would be with them, that you would guide their steps as they walk in you, that you would help them find their places in ministry, their places in the church family, the community, and everything that you long for them to have. And Lord, especially just that you would hold them in your hands all the days of their life as they walk with you. And may we help you in doing that and supporting them, encouraging them every day of their walk with you. Thank you so much for hearing these prayers and blessing them. In your name, Jesus, we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. All right. We got some gifts for you. One gift for the two of you, and then one gift for each of you. And we're going to invite Norton back up in a couple minutes. He's going to have a special song for us today, so I'm excited about that. Thank you guys so much. Very excited. Let me give you each a hug. Very excited to officially welcome you guys in. Hugs all around. All right. Great day, huh? Let's give them a hand. Yes. Make sure to show them love for you before they leave today. So now is our time of offering a prayer. And I just want to encourage you again, as I did last week, if you're coming to the end of the year and you're wondering, where should I give an offering? Some people are looking for their end of the year giving and their tax write-offs, whatever. I'd like to remind you that we still need help making our church budget for this year. We've only got this month and next month, and we are about $45,000 under budget. So I'd also like to encourage you, if you usually give to particular things, I will take that. Thank you very much. Thank you, Barbara. I wanted to stack them all up here, and I forgot because I've been too busy, but we're going to pray over this in a minute. But if you usually give to other funds, like you like to give to community services, or you like to give to evangelism, or maybe you know, other funds that you particularly like to give to. Our other funds are actually doing quite well right now. And I might ask you if you might consider for this month and next month, just consider instead of giving to separate funds that you might give into the church budget fund, since that's the one we're most in need of, and that could be a good help for us. So for those of you who, you know, members in your giving, if you're visiting here, your presence is a gift, and we're thankful you're here. As you know, you can give online, and you can also fill out an envelope and put that in the slot in the back or mail it into the church. Thank you so much for supporting that fund, because that's what helps us be church, helps us keep going. So, all right, now it's time for our prayer, and I just received this box. Thank you for all of you who contribute to the big stack of boxes that we have out there. Some of you also gave money to help with the shipping of these boxes. If you don't know what they are, these Christmas boxes get sent around the world to kids who are less fortunate, who could use a gift at Christmas time. And these boxes will get sent around the world. Children will open them up. It has their age and girl or boy on it, which is nice, and they'll open up these gifts and they'll get lots of great things, and they'll also get a message about Jesus. And so we want to pray that these boxes impact hearts and lives as they're sent around the world. They will be all collected, packed in a car, and sent off after church today. So we're going to add this in our prayers as we pray to God today. So I'd like to invite you, sit, stand, raise your hands, fold them, kneel, whatever you want to do, but we are going to come to our Lord, our God today together in prayer right now. Dear Father in heaven, we come before you first practicing gratitude. Remembering that you have blessed us in so many ways. We are alive. We are well enough to be here today, or to be sitting up and online today and watching this service. We have food in our bellies. We just all ate. We have clothes on our backs. We have shoes on our feet. We have been blessed by you. And Lord, we don't want to forget that you are the God who provides all these things. You are the God who brings the sunshine and the rain, causes all things to grow. You are the creator. You are the one who gave us life, that the breath in our lungs comes from you. And so, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for life, and then we thank you that on top of the life you've given us, you've also given us grace. You've given us forgiveness. You've expressed your patience with us. You've given us the promise of salvation, of forgiveness in you. You've given us the power of your Holy Spirit, the promise of your presence to help carry us through this world. Lord, your giving is unending. So we thank you. Lord, as we remember how blessed we are, we remember that there are people in this world that are lacking, that have much less than us. And we want to pray over these shoe boxes. This one here that represents our whole stack out in the lobby, and the many, many more being collected at so many churches and being sent out all over the world, Lord. We want to pray that your Spirit will be in every single box. That when the children open these boxes, that they would be flooded with your love and a sense of who you are. That it won't just be toys or fun things or things that they couldn't get otherwise, Lord, but it will mostly be you. And that they will come to know that there's a God who loves them. And Lord, that would stay with them all the days of their life. And that they would turn and give their lives back to you. Lord, we pray over these boxes. Put each one in the hands of just the right child for them to get something that will open their hearts to you. And Lord, we pray for all the things that we carry into this room today. We know it's the holidays and they can be hard. We want to pray for those among us who are grieving. We pray you will comfort their hearts, that it may be hard for them to be thankful at this time, but they could turn and thank you for the hope they have and know that you are with them. Lord, we pray for those who aren't well, that you would lay your healing hand on them. And we pray for ourselves that we would stay humble before our God, that you might continue doing the changing work in our lives that you promised that you would finish. Turn our eyes towards you, Lord. Fill us with your love. Make us loving, healing agents in this very broken world. For the glory of your name, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Right, Norton's coming back up. Give him a hand. We're so happy to have you, Norton. We're so thankful to get to hear and partake of your gifts that you're sharing with us and with God today. Thank you so much.
One, two, one, two.
Just a breath away. When I am restless, you're the one who stills me. And when I fail, you always stay the same. And you alone, I'm lifted up to heaven. And you alone, I fly on borrowed wings. When I reach the end, you are just beginning. And you alone, I find all that I need. When I am lost, you rescue me from danger. And when I fall, pick me up again. If I resist, your love past my defenses. Although I stray, you're patient till the end. And you alone, I'm lifted up to heaven. And you alone, or on borrowed wings. When I reach the end, you are just beginning. And you alone, I find all that I need. And you alone, I find all that I need. I reach the end. You are just beginning. And you alone. And you alone.
Thank you so much, Norton. Appreciate you sharing that blessing with us. And you alone, amen, we find all that we need. All right, we are in the last piece of our What is Church series. I thought this would be a great way to come into the week of Thanksgiving, because Thanksgiving is really about family and church is really about family. So it's a good partnership to wrap up our series on What is Church in this week, where we think about coming together and celebrating family. So let's just bow our heads. We'll have one more prayer as we get into the message today. Dear Father in heaven, God, I always need to bow my head before you and before I speak, because it is not by might nor by power, but only by your Spirit that we open our hearts, that we learn of you, that we see you, that we grow in you. And Lord, no one's really come here to hear from me today. We come to church to see our God. We come to church so your heart could teach us, could inspire us, could guide us, could revive us, could encourage us. So Lord, we need your Spirit today. So speak during this time, we pray, for your glory's sake, and we know that you will, because you are faithful. Thank you, Lord. In your name, Jesus, I pray. Amen. All right, What is Church Part 4 is about sharing. If you guys were here last week, then you heard Robert start off with this story. And I'll repeat it in case you forgot or you didn't hear it. There was a man that was stranded on an island. And when they finally came to rescue him, yes, kids can go to kids in church. Sorry, I didn't remind you that earlier. Feel free to go back and enjoy. So, the man was stranded on the island, and he was finally being rescued, and when they went to pick him up, he had built three huts. And so they asked him, well, what's the story of the three huts? And he said, well, this hut is my house. He said, okay. The second hut, well, that's my church. This third hut, well, that's my last church, and we don't talk about that church anymore. So well, that was a funny one, and applicable, because when we talk about church and what it means and what it is and what is it isn't, and just a reminder of what Robert brought up to us last week, is that the word for church in the Bible, ecclesia, it's actually the description of God's people. So the church is actually us. It's not the building. It's not the place. And it's not even the things that we do in the way that we worship. It's mostly the way that we are in the way that we worship together. It's mostly in the way that we do that with our heart. It's great that we have a building, because I know I look back and I think when God was calling me back to church, that's where you go, right? I feel like I'm looking for God, so you go to church. That's where you know to go to find him, right? And when you have a friend looking for God, then what do you like, invite them to come to church so they can learn more, right? So it's nice that we have a place, but it really is us functioning in that place that makes the difference. And to do that with love, to remember that everything else is just extra toppings, is so important. And I thought that when I was thinking about this, I remember this lesson that God was teaching me. When we first moved into our house, our fixer-upper, that is constantly in process of fixering-upping, as you guys know, I've told you many stories. But when we first moved in, we started working on it. I had this like vision in my mind, like we're going to make it perfect. I'd never fixed anything up in my life like this before, neither had Robert. My parents had done some of it, but they're not professionals. We don't have the money to pay professionals, but I still had, like, I wanted everything perfect. And I had this bad habit. If I look at something too close, I like want to fix every little detail. So I remember my dad would be working on stuff. My dad, you know, he's an electrical engineer in his life. He worked for Lockheed and worked in the space program. And he'd worked on our house, but he wasn't a construction worker. So even when he was younger, he wasn't perfect at it, right? So my dad is not the perfect construction worker. And I would get frustrated because things wouldn't be turning out just perfect, right? And then, you know, the outlet would be just a tad crooked. he put that box not where I would want it on the wall. You know what I mean? And then I would get irritated. And then I'd be praying. I'm like, Lord, it's not good for me to be irritated. But I'm really bothered because I see it over there. And it's not where I would want it. It's not what I wanted to, you know, like. And I get bothered. I'm like, this isn't a good feeling. I'm a Christian. What's wrong with me? And I'm like praying. And I'm so glad for the Holy Spirit because, you know, when I sit with God and I listen to him and he says to me, Sandy, it's not about the outlet. Because one day, sooner than you'd like it to be, your dad's going to be gone. And when you look at that little crooked outlet, you're going to remember your dad. And are you going to remember that you were cranky with your dad? Or are you going to remember and cherish that you had the opportunity to do projects with your dad? It's not about the outlet. When we come to church, it's not about the food. It's not about how nice the building looks. It's not about the decor. It's not about how perfect the service is. It's about our opportunity to sit with one another and love each other. And to cherish the fact that we get to be with like-minded people, searching for God together, celebrating him and learning together, a place where we can be loved and share that. So that's the thing. That's church. So that's what Robert was talking about last week. Church is about the people. Church is who we are. Church is how we are together. A little bit of a review. So we also looked at this. Last time I preached a couple weeks back, I went over this picture, discipleship. I like to review this at least once a year for us so we remember what it means when we're called to love God, to love others. And Jesus invites us to come follow him and then go make disciples. So what we talked about my last two sermons, the green one was seeking, how we come and seek God, being church part one, what is church part one, how we love others, the reflecting, how that should change our character and make us more loving people. That was part two. And now we're on part three, part four, combined together because Robert did part three. We're looking at the training, the spiritual gifts, and the sharing aspect. What it means to go make disciples and how all that ties into being church. So there's this verse in Matthew 28, 18 to 20. It says, and Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. So this is what we call the Great Commission, because it's right there what we're called to do as church. This is our purpose. Our purpose is church. Go, therefore, and make disciples. Basically, go, therefore, and make more people who are growing to be loving people like you. Grow the kingdom of love. That's what that's talking about. That's what we're called to do, right? And I love that Jesus packages this by first saying, I have all the power, and I will be with you, so I'm going to help you do this. It's not just up to us. He's going to help us. He's going to empower us to do this, right? So we have this thing. What is church for? To go make disciples, to do this. So part one of this discipleship for today. Actually, it's step three, the training part. 1 Corinthians says, now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of services, but the same Lord, and there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. For the common good. So remember, he said he has all authority. He will give us the Holy Spirit. We're baptized into the Holy Spirit. Through the Holy Spirit, we're all given gifts so that we can all be part of this common good, which is to build the kingdom of love. Multiply this opportunity for people to come in and be loved and find forgiveness and become more loving people. So this is the common good. And we all have different spiritual gifts to do this. So I want to talk about how we all work together using these gifts. Today, sorry, I have this a little bit tight. I'm feeling like I can't move my head. All right, that's better. Squirrel, sorry about that. All right, so today, just today, how many different gifts were used so that we could all enjoy the sense of church? Well, you had somebody who came early and unlocked the doors and got things organized. They even actually came last night and set up the tables and the chairs. So that's called deacons. So we have the gifts of helps going on. And they're still here helping with stuff. And they will be here after we're done helping putting everything away. Then you've got the people at the door that greet you. So that's what we call the gift of hospitality, along with the people who do the food, right? So we have food, we have hospitality, right? We have the gift of administration. Thank you so much for being the coordinator and making sure that we know when we're supposed to come up front and follow the rule, the schedule, right? So we have the gift of administration in the coordinators. We have the gift of music. We have the gift of, it's partly an art, partly a help talent, but back there in AV, they pick out the nice videos that we have and finagle, like they do the whole, like, when to go close up on Sandy and when do I back up and all that kind of stuff, right? So we got them helping back there. All of this together and the teachers that are teaching about God, all of this together is the body working together to help people be disciples. This is a great thing about us coming together as church, that we collaborate, we complete each other, you complete me. It's a beautiful thing because that's what makes church vibrant. That's what makes when we invite a friend in the door to find out what Christianity is, because every part of the body is doing something, they find out what it really is. It's one thing if they come in and only the pastor is here and they sit down in a pew and I talk about who Jesus is, that's great. But when they come in and see a body of people working together, loving one another, welcoming them, feeding them, helping them, supporting them, giving, donating to make this all possible, then people experience God's love firsthand. All right, so we have the variety of gifts that makes us church, but we have something else that happens. Acts 1:8 says this, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." So in other words, starting with the point that you're at, you will be my witnesses in Modesto, in California, in the United States, and in the rest of the world. Starting right where you're at, you're going to be my witnesses. That word witness, it means a couple of things. The first thing that it means is to be one that shares the story of what God has done for you. Right? If I were to bring you into court for you to be a witness, then you would testify. And you would only do that if you had a firsthand account of something. So we do this to witness to our firsthand account of God. All right, so I want you all to practice this really quick, just for a minute. It's pretty quick. I want you all to fill in, think of the sentence and fill in the blank. I thank God for blank. Just think of it right now. I thank God for, how would you fill in that blank? All right, now you all thought of something? Now I want you to turn to the person next to you, and I want you to look at them and say, I thank God for, and tell them. And if you're online, you can text them. If you're sitting by yourself and don't want to walk around, you can text somebody. I thank God for. All right, You all just witnessed to one another. You just witnessed. You just shared that God is good in your life in some way, and that's how easy witnessing actually can be. Our testimony doesn't have to be some great, detailed, long thing. Like, people wonder, how do I share my testimony? What is my testimony, and how do I share it? Or, I don't feel like I have a very interesting testimony. Your testimony is just simply, how has God been good to you in your life? That's all it is. It's very simple. It can be recent. It can be way in the past. It can be the big deal, the thing that changed me from being a rock and roller partier chick to finding out that there's a better way of life and God changed me and set my feet on a new course. It could be a big thing. It could be what happened last night. God has saved me in a million ways, from big things to small things. So last night, my little recent testimony. I pray for your pastor. I'm such a mess. I am. I am. Robert and I will often just look at each other and go, we are still just two broken rockers saved by God's grace, trying to share Jesus in this world. That's who we are. And there are times that I'm like sitting and I'm just feeling, and I'm like, this is how I feel. I am really, I'm like, God, I'm messing up. For the last few weeks, 2 or 3 weeks, Robert and I both felt like we're on this pendulum. We're either really busy or we're really burnt out. And when you live on that pendulum, that means when we have to work for work, we get up and we're working really hard for work. When we get home and we're really burnt out, and if you do not want to come to my house right now, do not come knock at my door right now, okay? Because that means that anything that we feel unnecessary is not getting done. It's not counted as necessary right now. And I'm sitting in my house, and I know that I'm behind, and I've been missing things because I'm burnt out. I'm not staying on top of things well, and I'm feeling bad about it. I'm like, God, I'm so tired. I got my hair cut, finally. If you notice, you can see my eyes. I fell asleep while I was at the salon. That's how burnt out I am. I'm like, oh, don't cut my hair wrong while I nod off on you. And so I'm like just praying. I'm like, God, I feel like such a mess. I don't feel ready for tomorrow. I didn't check in with people to make sure everyone was reminded about prepping for potluck or having the gifts for the baptism. I'm like just behind. And here's God saving me again. I'm praying for his grace. I'm asking for his forgiveness. I'm asking for his help. And his Holy Spirit comes to me. And he speaks into my mind. And what he said to me is like, do you think I'm surprised? You know the end from the beginning, so probably not, right? Do you think that I have grace for even this time in your life? And then he says to me, this beautiful lesson, Sandy, remember, it is not about perfection, it is about perseverance. Because if it were about perfection, everyone would give up. We would all give up. Perseverance says that we keep striving to walk in him, and that way we can keep growing. Sometimes it's 3 steps forward, 2 steps back. And I'm sitting there like feeling horrible, and now all of a sudden I'm feeling loved. I'm feeling encouraged. I'm feeling like I can get through this. That is what we do when we witness. Because now when I come up to a person who's that place in their life, I'm like, you know what? If everything else in your house is a mess right now, things feel like they're falling apart, remember it's perseverance, not perfection. Hang on. That's from God, by the way. He loves you. We're called to witness. This is what God wants us to do. And what happens is when we're in church together, as church together, we get to all be this body and all use these gifts, and all these gifts come together in these beautiful ways so that we have stuff for the kids and we have outreach stuff to the farmer's market and we have community service and we can love the community and we can help each other achieve that. But when we all go out separately and witness, This is how we spread out into all of Jerusalem. As God's people multiply, we're like a net. You see, Jesus said to his disciples, I will make you fishers of people, because they were fishermen, right? When we spread out in the community and we're all sharing and witnessing, and through that witnessing, different people may be collected and then come into church, we're fishing with a net. We're witnessing. And that's what God calls us to be as church, to share his love so more people can come into it by witnessing. All right, there's another part of this word, witnessing. The word witness in Greek is where we get the word martyr. Now when we translate that verse, you will be my martyrs in Modesto, in California. We're like, oh, that's serious. That's really serious. These are the definitions of martyr from Merriam-Webster's online dictionary. A person who voluntarily suffers death as the penalty of witnessing to and refusing to renounce a religion. A person who sacrifices something of great value and especially life itself for the sake of principle. I like those put together because our religion isn't just some inanimate thing. It isn't just some list of decrees put on a wall. Our religion is about love. Our religion is about the kingdom of love. That's what Christianity is supposed to be about. And therefore, it's a principle that we cannot surrender. We cannot afford to surrender love in this world of hate. I will not surrender it. I will love both Democrats and Republicans. I will not surrender it in this world of hate. I will share Jesus. I will share his love, even if people turn against me, because I can't afford not to in this broken world. It's a principle that is worth dying for. That's what it means to witness, to choose to be a martyr like Jesus was. So we come to Galatians 2:20, which says this, I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I love this text. It is one of my very favorites, and you probably heard me say that about a lot, but this is really one of my very, very favorites. It's like really high up there. It's really, really high up there. Because this is the beauty of the gospel, that Jesus came and he was willing to be a martyr for love. He was willing to subject himself to people of hate in order to show the world what love is, in order to love us, and in order to save us. And when we choose him, when we choose salvation in him, and we choose to align with his kingdom, when we choose to admit that I cannot change myself and I want the power of Christ in me, then we come to him and we say, I'm willing to be your witness. I'm willing to be a martyr. I'm willing to die with you. I'm willing to be crucified with you so your spirit can live in me. That's the whole point of the gospel, the choice of Jesus. That's what church is, the centerpiece of church. So Romans 6:3-4 says this, do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? Therefore, we have been buried with him through baptism into death, so that as Christ is raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. That newness of life is love. The ability to show others the same grace that God shows us, the same patience he gives us, the same forgiveness that he gives us. That newness of life, and we're not good at it. That's why we need his spirit to be in us to help us do it, to help us grow in it. This is the gospel. This is church. So when we look at what it means to be a church member, to be part of church, to be his disciples, we see this whole picture that we are called to love God and love others. that as we come closer to him, we grow in reflecting him. As we grow in reflecting him, we desire his community to grow. As we desire his community to grow, we learn about how we work together, and we use our spiritual gifts, and we want to witness, and we're willing to be a martyr, and we're willing to sacrifice, because it is worth sharing. It is worth sharing his love and wanting others to come to it. And that's just scratching the surface, because I didn't even mention that we get eternal life. On top of experiencing love, we get eternal life, and hopefully eternal life with those who choose him. Well, for sure, eternal life with those who choose him. But hopefully more will choose him to share that world with us. So here we go to wrap up. Beloved, this is church. Let us love one another. For love is from God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. The one who does not love does not know God, for God is love. And this is church. So, Thanksgiving, such a great time for family, such a great time to be grateful for one another, such a great time to celebrate the love we have together. So thank you for everybody who brought food. We were a little short this time. I hope everyone got something to eat. We have a few families that are all away on vacation right now, so I did notice we usually have a bit more on our potlucks, but I hope everyone got to eat together, and I hope everybody got to bond a little bit more together in love and celebrate our holiday. Now we're going to celebrate something very special. We're going to celebrate those that are choosing to give their life to God, and I'm going to invite Jamie and Catherine to head back. And I first want to thank and encourage right now the whole church family to remember, it is because you do what you do here at church that people are getting baptized today. It is because you have greeted them at the door. It is because you have fed them. It is because you worked at the AV. It is because you taught in a class. It is because you sat next to them, you welcomed them, you did your part as church here, you organized the service for us and kept us on track. Whatever it was, you played music, you sang, you played the organ, all the things that make us church, all that thing that they came in and experienced when they came here that helped them grow in their life in God until the point that they say, I'm giving my life to God. We are celebrating this as family. That we're achieving what God has called us to do, to make disciples. So enjoy this moment and remember that you're a part of it, that you are a part of this. And then I want to share one more thing before I head back, and that is this. If you're sitting here in church today and you're thinking, you know what? I'm ready to choose that community of love. I'm ready to say that I can't do this on my own. I'm not good at being forgiving. I'm not good at staying away from my addictions. And I have never really said, Jesus, I want to give you my life. And I want your help. And if you are ready to make that decision, to be buried with him and resurrected in new life, you're very welcome to head on back. We've got robes. We've got towels. We'll tell you exactly how it all goes. And I'd be very happy to celebrate you giving your life to God today. All right, let me pray before I head back there. Dear Father in heaven, God, as we go into this time of this worship music and praising you and celebrating this baptism, Lord, we just want to thank you for your great love, for your forgiveness, for your grace, for inviting us to be part of your family, for the privilege of being church by the power of your Spirit. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
I'll say it again. Good morning. He was going to open up, but he's dropped his pack. It'll be just a second.
Okay. All right. Happy Sabbath, everybody. God bless you. Happy holidays. Happy Thanksgiving. Let me think of any other corny things that I want to say because I know I don't look like it, but I'm that guy. You know, I love seeing your beautiful faces every Sabbath, you know, because it's good to have fellowship together, you know. And I got to say, what a wonderful pastor we have in this house. Oh, my God. She is, amen. So we really got a good setup for you. I love the special song that was sung. Oh, beautiful. Great job. Great job. Well, hey, listen, I can talk all day, but I want you to stand with us and prepare your hearts for worship as we go through our set. Come on, stand with us. We got some songs we believe that will touch your heart, but we can only do our part. Make sure. Doing a sound check.
Miracle worker, I don't feel that you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see that you're working. Even when I don't feel that you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Feel free to be seated if you would like. If you want to continue to stand, you may as well. Just whatever you feel like doing to enter into worship this morning.
Of the goodness of God.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. So much to be thankful for, Father. Thank you, Jesus.
give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks.
Amen.
She's already all teared up. What a perfect song. I hear her singing it with her heart, meaning this. Many of you know Catherine. She's been coming here for a while. She's been through a lot. She came here because she knew that God was calling her back to Him. And many, many of you have been part of her journey back to God. And it's such a special day to come to this moment. She knew it was coming. She told me a while ago, I'm going to want to be rebaptized. And now here we are. What a special week. Giving your thanks to God, giving your life back to God. She wants to thank her family and friends that are here. She was going to say something to you. Do you feel like saying something or are you just going to cry?
I can say something.
Okay. Let's see if you can hear her. Okay. I'll lean in.
I wanted to thank everybody that I have met during my stay here at this church. I love you guys all truly and dearly. Everybody has a special place in my heart, and thank you for my family for coming and supporting me.
Amen, amen. She's got lots of family here. Catherine's family, will you guys raise your hands? I know you're raising your cell phones, but then everyone will know where you're at. Thank you for coming. All right, ready? I'm going to pray a blessing on you first. Dear Father in heaven, we know that you're so happy that your daughter has come home to you. You're happy to celebrate this moment with her, and you are here with us. Lord, I just pray in this moment that she will become that living sanctuary that she desires to be. Lord, I claim your faithfulness that you will never leave her from this day forward as she gives her life to you. Thank you so much. In your name, Jesus, I pray. Amen. Catherine, because you've come back home and you're saying, Lord, I give you my life. I want to follow you all the days of my life. I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're going to have to do something about this mic. It seems that I cannot baptize without getting it hit by a wave. I'll try. I don't know. If I can speed it up a little bit higher. All right. I want to invite Jamie in. And, oh my goodness. Y'all might cry here. Oops, careful. Careful. Watch that. First, I want to introduce Jamie. Jamie has been through such a journey in her life to come to this moment, and God has saved her in many, many ways. I don't want to share too much of her story, but I hope that her and Catherine, and maybe her relatives that are about to step in the tank, might share their own stories with you, because it is very powerful the way that God has saved them. And this is a really special day, because God is doing a work in her family, and I want to invite in two of her family members. This is Brenda. And Brenda, when was the last time you were in a church? It's been a while. It's been a while since she's been able to come to church. And Lizette, right? Lizette. When was the last time you were in a church? Last week? Good for you. Good for you. We are so happy that these two have decided today to give their lives to Jesus. Just today they decided they came to see Jamie. You know, when we witness the power of God in our life, it is a domino effect. Sometimes people will change in slow steps, and sometimes that step will be now is the moment. And to have this family, you guys in here together, giving your life to Jesus, such a beautiful moment. I know we were in tears in the back room, and I feel so honored to be able to baptize you all together. So we are going to, if I could have you guys sit back. Dear Father in heaven, I'm going to pray over these three women all together, over Jamie, Brenda, and Lizette. Lord, this family, that you are doing a miracle working power in their lives. You are letting them know that you love them, that you have the changing power that they need in their lives. And Lord, they've heard your call to join your family, to come home, to be one with their Father again, to be filled by your Spirit, to choose to walk in you, Lord. And I claim your faithfulness to never let them go. Your word says you love them with an everlasting love. Your word says that you will finish the work that you're beginning in them in this day. Lord, your word says that you will empower them with your Spirit, that you will guide their steps, that they will hear a voice behind them saying, this is the way, walk ye in it. Your word says you will empower them with gifts and with the blessing of purpose and direction in their life, Lord. You are faithful to everything your word says. And most of all, your word says that because they're choosing you, they will be saved and have eternal life in you, eternal life with the God who loves them. So, Lord, we claim all these promises in their lives today as they give their lives to you in baptism. And we claim this in your name, Jesus, and for your glory. Amen. Now, Jamie, because you've chosen to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior and commit your life to him, and he commits his life to you already, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, Jesus Christ, and his Holy Spirit. Amen. All right, you can stand over here so you can all hug right after. My mic's not working. It's iffy. You know what? I don't want to splash down another one. I'm going to just speak really loud. Okay? Hope I don't blast your ears out. I'll speak really loud because otherwise I'm just going to kill a second mic probably with a little tidal wave in here. All right. Lizette, I am so happy. I'm so happy to celebrate this time with Lizette. Amen? Amen? Lizette, because you have chosen Jesus as your Savior, I'm so happy to now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I don't know how much. I'm glad you pinched your nose yourself. I didn't want to mess you up, right? All right, so you can hold on. Bend this way, bend that way. And go back, just bend a little bit. And lean back and then pull yourself up. Hold on to my arm. Okay, take it easy. Yeah, I'm going to help you. We're talking logistics here, so everybody knows. Sometimes they're not sure about how the actual part works, right? They're just making sure they're not surprised by anything. All right, Brenda, we are so excited to celebrate this moment with you because you have decided to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. I now baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. What a great day, huh? What a great way to kick off Thanksgiving week. I'm so happy you are all here to celebrate our family growing and God moving. And I want to wish you all a very wonderful Thanksgiving. Look forward to seeing you next Sabbath. Please don't feel like you have to wait for me to come back out. It's going to take a minute. But if you can wait and you want to congratulate the baptismal candidates, all of them who just gave their life to God, I'm sure they'd be happy to have you shake their hand when they finish drying off and get out there. But please don't feel like you have to wait for me to come out and say something else. I had that happen once. I came out and everyone was still waiting for me. All right, so you guys have a great week. Love you. A very happy Thanksgiving to you, and we'll see you next Sabbath. Bye-bye.